Good morning. Is my screen visible, Rashwin?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. I'll go directly. Text I'm not looking directly now. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So we'll see some situations of how to treat the water. Okay. How to treat the water. And you can also have a feed lake in a city and how they tap water and how the treatment systems will work out and how you get wholesome or potable water in the doorsteps. That's what now the different vision points by the government of India would have noticed. Okay, so it is also being given at a particular time, 2021 or 22 or 23 or 24 or 25, you may get potable water in the doorsteps. That's the vision of the government right now. People are working and how the system moves, that we are in a position to discuss. Okay, so this is something is important. And this initial part, I guess we have discussed in the during your the content or concept mapping class also. Okay, yes. Okay. The water source, you are familiar, right? Water source, we have discussed elaborately. And this pumping also we have discussed. So this is already complete. This portion is already being completed. We have discussed enough in detail. Is it fine? Okay. So water sources have predominantly been classified into surface water and also groundwater. But please remember, these treatment systems are not uniform because the surface water and the groundwater are different in characteristics. Okay. And if you recall, if you want to treat surface water and the predominant characteristics, then you have to concentrate this only on solids. It may be either in suspended form or in a floating form, total suspended solids, or slight portion of organic sediments as well, okay, organic solids as well. But in the case of groundwater, solids might be there, but this is in the form of either organic or inorganic, predominantly dissolved inorganic matters that probably we would have discussed with. We have discussed with these phenomena as well. Okay, surface water, it is the main sources from rainfall. Depending upon the catchment area characteristics, you may also get water with the different characteristics. That also we discussed. In the case of groundwater and rainfall falls in, and if the soil is with a high permeable or infiltrator capability, it will also allow the water to pass in during the transport in the subsurface soil. And it will also take away a lot of soluble components like the minerals along with the travel. It will also mix with the groundwater status. Okay, and if you pump groundwater, which may contain the solids in a dissolved form, especially calcium, magnesium, sodium, that what you are discussing, different inorganic chemical characteristics. Okay, and it is also rich in the dissolved gases like carbon dioxide and other dissolved gases. Carbon dioxide is predominantly, and it may also, groundwater also may contain a lot of iron and manganese. Okay, so that's what, if you look into the treatment chain or layout, treatment chain is not almost same, similar to the surface water treatment and groundwater treatment. Okay, so please remember, in the case of surface water treatment, I have to be very concentrated or look into the solids removal. In the case of groundwater, then the predominant, I have to remove the inorganic mineral composition, plus if it is possible to remove dissolved gases and iron and manganese. Okay. So we'll discuss the treatment chain separately for surface water and also groundwater. Okay. Yes. Yeah. So now you just look into the diagram in a clarity way. Okay. So imagine water from a catchment area, it has been collected. Surface water sources like river, lake, pond, reservoir or something. Okay, so while you are taking or withdrawing or tapping water from water source to a pumping station, okay, or intermediate point, you may also use screens. That's something is important. They may use screens. Okay, predominantly they may. I think if you remember what we have discussed in the intake towers and with the screen. Okay, it's very simple. And if the particle, based on your the size of fraction of the solids, you may also select the size of screen opening also. Okay, And if the size of the opening, this is bigger than the solids what is present in the water, it will allow to escape. Say, imagine now a situation where the screen sizes is very smaller and solids are bigger. So what will happen? There could be possibilities of retention of solids. It will not allow the solids to escape from a system. Thereby, solids will be retained. Okay, the water which is coming out of after screening, which is free from solids, but the problem is it may contain a lot of colloidal and sometimes dissolved organic and also inorganic matters. Predominantly, these are very, very small, minute colloidal particles also will come into or escape from treatment of or escape from screening operation. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Please remember, solids are suspended form, but is very, very tiny, okay, which includes solids plus silt plus clay plus others. Okay, solids, silt, clay, and other materials. Okay, these are very, very tiny. Okay, there is a feasibility to remove these solids by keeping in a tank or keeping in a vessel, ideally for 2-3 days. There could be possibilities of settling. Okay, that's what normally we do in normal household activities. Okay, if it is being with a if you fetch the water from a pond or from a lake, what they do? They may not immediately use it, and they keep the water. Normally, they used to keep the water for a period of time, 1 day or 2 days, allow the solid to settle. That is very simple. That is just by simple gravity settling. Okay. So imagine our situation. If it is in a city water supply, it is very, very difficult to keep this much quantity of water with the solids of very tiny in shape or tiny in nature for a long period of time. One is this about, you may not meet out your demand, that is number one. Number two is about you need to have a bigger tanks to store the water, and because these particles are very, very lighter, which may be in the specific gravity range of 1 to 1.1, it may take more time to settle down. That is number one. Number two is, these particles are already an inert material which may have a negatively charged, because normally, that anyway, that we'll be discussing in detail, particles may acquire a charge, okay, because of some conditions or because of phenomena which may happen in the solids. Okay, that we'll discuss in later part. You just remember right now, the particles are highly negatively charged. So what will happen? Because of this negativity in nature, and these particles are ripple each other. Okay, these particles are rippling. It will not allow the particle to settle. Is it okay? Okay, these particles are negatively charged, and because of this same equal charges, it will ripple each other. Okay, so what I do, if I normally it is being clustered with two different forces, one is about repulsive force, another one is about attractive force. Please make a note on repulsive and attractive. Repulsive force and attractive force. Okay, so if it is this repulsive force is more, the particles are apart, it will not allow the particles to collide or attach each other, thereby it will take more time to settle by gravity settling. Okay, ripple each other. Okay, so if I want to make the particles closer, or if I want to make the particles to collide each other to form a bigger flux, what I do, I have to reduce the repulsive force. Am I right? Is it okay? I have to reduce the repulsive force, then only the particles can able to collide each other, and this will part, these particles will become like this. And if it is 2-3 particles attached to each other, it may becomes like a flock which may gain gravity, and automatically it will settle down. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
So please understand the logical things. So repulsive force are more because particles are negatively charged. It will ripple each other. It will not allow the particle to become closer. Okay, and now in the treatment system, what I do, I have to make them to collide each other, or make them the particles to close each other, or move each other or meet together. And for that, I may use, this may not happen automatically, then I may use some sort of chemicals. That system we may call it as destabilization. Okay, or otherwise you just simply you remember, the particles in the water are completely on colloids. Okay, colloids, if the particles are tend to be like colloids, it will ripple each other, it will not settle. or it will not collide each other. What I do, I have to destabilize the colloids, thereby these particles will become something like this, something like this, and which can be subsequently removed in the sedimentation process or settling tank. Is it okay? So this may not happen automatically. This I have to add some chemicals, that chemical is called as coagulant. Please make a note on that. Okay, coagulant is the chemical, coagulation is the process, okay, destabilization is the mechanism. Okay, that is the first step. You have to add coagulant here. Please remember, the water which is coming into a treatment plant is still contain a lot of solids, but solids are in a very very tiny colloidal form. If I leave it as such, it will not allow or it will not settle. Sometimes is years together. If it is very tiny particle remains particles. You would have seen some of the elevated lakes, water becomes very turbid because of these turbid particles or colloidal particles. It will not settle or destabilize at all. Okay, so this can happen because of the addition of chemicals. That chemicals are called as coagulant. Okay, and the process called coagulation. Okay, so that let me discuss the types of coagulants later, but you just understand what is coagulant. Okay, so the coagulant addition, okay, this I had to purge the chemical, okay, or disperse the chemical effectively in the water stream. This also may not happen because water flow is very very heavy and pumping rate is heavy, and whatever you purge, coagulant is very very smaller in dose. And that's what, now you have to design a system called rapid mix. It's very simple. You disperse chemical with some mixing mechanism or dispersion mechanism. That's something is important. Please make a note on this is the unit process number one, rapid mixing. Okay, let me make it very clear. Rapid mixing is for dispersion or addition of chemicals along with the water by simple mechanism. Simple mechanisms called vertical mixing or by turbine mixing or by blending, whatever you call. Okay, you just thoroughly mix the chemical to the in-stream water, okay, or the water. Thereby, there could be a possibilities of addition of chemical into the water stream. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Is it fine? This is something like this is a dispersion of chemical. Okay, so here what will happen? Destabilization may happen, but I will not allow the particle to coagulate or meet each other like this, because the condition of mixing is very very faster, very very faster. So only it will allow the destabilization to happen, but it will not form a very very bigger flocks. Okay, so this is unit number one or process number one. Okay, number two is, now whatever the destabilized colloids, okay, has to be made into a flocks. Okay, made into a flocks. Now because of this rapid mixing, it will not do some flocks like that, but particles are already a destabilized one. Okay, the second mechanism or second unit process is called flocculation. Okay, so what I do, I may provide a very very gentle mixing. So thereby two three similar kind of, okay, imagine now we have a destabilized colloids like right now. Okay, I may go for a gentle mixing, very simple gentle mixing. Thereby there could be a possibility of the clusters of these particles may attach each other, which will form a weaker flocks like this. Is it okay? Is it fine?
Yes.
Flocculation is a system. Okay, I will enhance the destabilized particles to form a flock. Is it okay? Okay, by the way of giving some sort of simple agitation or mixing. Okay, so what here is only destabilization. Here in the tank, you may get an agglomeration or aggregation of particles may happen. Here it is destabilization, and here the unit number two, where we have a destabilization of colloids. Aggregation or agglomeration of colloids. Okay, so if the two, three particles of destabilized particles may attach together, it will form an aggregate or it will form a flock, okay, and which may also gains gravity. And because of gentle mixing in this tank, I will not allow the particle to settle. It is already with the flock or with the aggregate gains gravity because of mixing. Here the particles may not be allowed to settle down. Okay, please make a note on aggregation of particles may happen only in the flocculation chamber. You can provide a very simple or gentle mixing. Okay, imagine now a situation with the like a mixture like this. It will also rotate in a clockwise direction. So what will happen? Here is one particle and here it is one particle, and thus a blade will sometimes is target this particle. Okay, or sometimes this is which will enhance these particles to collide these particles, thereby it will become like this. Individually may not gain gravity, but if it is 2-3 particles together, it may sometimes gain gravity, which is become a bigger flock. Okay, yes. So aggregation of particles may happen in a flocculation chamber. Okay, yes. Now what do you do after flocculation? And now the particles are with the higher gravity, then it is possible to segregate by a simple gravity separation techniques. That is called simple sedimentation, or you can call it as settling, or simply you can call it as clarification. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So please remember, here it is aggregation. Thus, aggregated particles has to be separated from the water by simple action of gravity. The solids or destabilized colloids, that we can call it as a chemical sludge or waste sludge, because the combination of coagulants plus your colloidal particle, that is being called as chemical sludge or waste sludge, and you can remove from the PS sedimentation or clarification tank. And clarified water is free from aggregates. Okay, yes, free from aggregates. Okay, so here, okay, the aggregated particles or aggregates are different size and shape and different compositions. Okay, because all the particles may not be in a uniform size and shape. Some particles may be bigger and some particles may be lighter, some particles may be with specific gravity of almost 1.01. okay, in this settling also I may not be in a position to remove 100% of aggregates, 100% of destabilized colloids, because particles are different size ranges. It is not good to keep the water for long period of time, because it may require a bigger sedimentation tank. The construction cost is very, very high. So what I do, I may also go for a particular detention time in the clarification unit. Okay, for say example, for a 5 hours of duration, and I may go for some sort of a separation, and 60% is also okay for me. 60% of removal of aggregated colloids or aggregated the solids is okay for me, and remaining I may take care in the other subsequent units. Is it fine?
Yeah.
So what is happening now? Here in the sedimentation tank, bigger particles will settle because of gravity. Lighter particles will come along with the clarified effluent. Okay. So what do you do now? Whatever it is coming out from the second clarification units are destabilized colloids. These are very, very tiny. These are already destabilized, but already very, very tiny particles. What I do now, I may have a simple filter unit. I may use some sort of simple filter unit. Okay. Simple filter unit. Okay. These filter units are different size fractions of, say example, gravel, sand. It has been arranged by a systematic layers. You just allow the destabilized, the aggregates to pass from top to bottom. Okay, depending upon the rate, depending upon your operation, you may have different classifications. Anyway, that we'll be discussing in detail later. But imagine now, I have to separate the solids. That is my objective. Okay, that is something very simple. Okay, very simple. And probably I would have seen how they make tea. Okay, how they make tea. So they may add tea powder. They may also add the milk, boil it. And if I want to remove tea powder out of the tea, what do? You may use kettle. You may use strainer. Okay, you may use strainer. Okay, strainer. But in the case of the filters, the top layer of the sand layer will act as a micro strainer like this, okay, which will not allow the particles to penetrate further. That's the only difference. I wanted to separate, say example, the solids out of the water stream. Okay, I may use different layers of or size fractions of sand layer by layer, Imagine now, you just, the top layer of the sand will act as a micro strainer, and which may not allow the particles to penetrate further. Thereby, retention of solids may happen at the top. Okay, and the solids will be trapped at the top, and you may get a water, treated water downwards. And during the course of time, the efficiency of the filter also will come down. Okay, come down. What the efficiency is coming down means is all your the micro pores are getting blocked. So what I do, I may go for a cleaning of filter, or simply you can call it as backwashing of filter. So please remember, during operation, you can allow the water to flow from top to bottom. And during the course of time, all your micro sediments or aggregates are getting blocked onto a surface of your filter. The efficiency of the filter will come down. Now you have to regenerate the filter. For that, you have to go for a backwashing. It's very simple. You just reverse the flow, and whatever it is already been blocked inside the interstices of your soil particles, okay, sometimes because of the higher flow, because of the backwashing, and these particles already been blocked inside the interstices of your soil particles getting loosened up, and that you can remove or wash out at the top of the filter. Okay, please remember, during the filtration, the flow rate is on downwards, and during the cleaning operation, that may be upwards. So thereby I could be able to remove most of the solids or colloidal solids by these filtration mechanisms. Okay, so this is very simple. Okay, so if you take out the filtered water, which is almost is free from all the solids, and next operation is your disinfection. Remember, because if you are with surface water sources, there could be large amount of microbial sediments also, or bacteriological contamination also. None of the treatment systems like the flocculator or sedimentation or filtration, which may not remove 100% of your micro solids or micro sediments or microbiological bacteria and also virus. Okay, and the treated effluent, the treated water also, or filtered water also may get a lot of microbiological contaminations, especially bacteria and also virus that I had to kill. For that, I may go for a disinfection activity. So this is number fourth unit operation. This may be a fifth operation. That is either destruction or complete removal of pathogens by the addition of disinfectants in the water. You can simply call it as disinfection. So that probably you would have seen in the household also. They may use either bleaching powder, or they may use different techniques like UV, okay, purging of UV into the water, or they may use ozone. Most of the household units that what you would have seen in households, they may use UV disinfection or ozone disinfection. Okay, so once it is disinfected, okay, water it is free from bacterial contamination also. You can comfortably store in the storage well, in the underground, or in the elevated water tank, and with the requirement, you can also supply to the consumers without any difficulty. Is it okay?
Yeah.
So what is the first unit operation? Please look into the diagram. You can interact with me. Okay, this is very, very, very basic. And further classes, we are going to elaborate individual unit operation. That's all. Okay, yeah. So please create some interest, because water chemistry and water treatment, this is something that is very, very immediate, because a lot of projects, so many projects in different across India, they may do water treatment and water distribution networks. You can create some interest on water chemistry. You can also learn something better. This is also something is good for your, say example, higher education as well, to get into some good universities with your master's or something. Okay. So what is unit operation number one? So those who are familiar, you can interact with me now for 5 minutes. Yeah. What is the unit number one, unit operation number one? Come on. What is unit operation number one? Yeah, make it fast.
Pump station.
Number one is rapid mixing. Okay, anyway, that you just leave it. Anyway, we are discussing only on treatment. Rapid mixing. What is the purpose of rapid mixing? Is the mixing of chemical to the water or coagulant to the water. Is it okay?
Yes.
What is the second unit operation?
Flocculation.
Flocculator. Okay, flocculation is the technique, and flow, okay, flocculation. What is the purpose of flocculation?
Colloidal particles into aggregate.
Yeah, destabilized colloids are made into a small aggregates or agglomerated particles, thereby which gains gravity by simple agitation or gentle mixing mechanism. Is it okay? Here in the flocculation, I will not allow the particle to settle further. Okay. What is the next unit operation? Third one.
Sedimentation of
sedimentation. What is sedimentation?
Settling of.
Separation of particles by simple action of gravity. That's all. Okay. What is the next unit operation after sedimentation?
Filter.
Filtration. Filtration. What is this? What is the purpose of filtration here? Again.
Removal of.
Removal, or you can say because not removal, retention. Retention of. Retention of microflocks. Microflux, because which is not been removed from a primary settling tank, that can be handled in a simple filter or filtrations. Okay, so what is the different operations in the filter? During operation, you can allow the water to pass from top to bottom. And during the close up time, the efficiency of the filter will come down, or the pores in between the soil grains is getting blocked. Then you have to clean the filter by simple action by backwashing.
Backwash.
Is it okay? Okay. What is the next unit operation after filter?
Disinfection.
Yeah. By what is disinfection? Disinfection is either destruction or killing of microorganisms. Okay. Killing of microorganisms is because the previous unit operations may not in a position to remove as much as disease-causing organisms, or it will not kill or remove. So we have to now purge chemicals. What are the different disinfectants? You can add chlorine, or you can add the UV, or you can add ozone. Okay, chlorine would have seen familiar. Chlorine related chemicals, chlorine dioxide, bleaching powder, and something, and addition of light, that is UV light, and you can also use ozone disinfection acids. Okay, this is removal of all pathogenic bacteria. So once it is being removed, okay, you can store it in a treatment plant itself, or you can store it to a place where you want to distribute by simple clear underground wells, and then based on your requirement, and you can also distribute to the consumers. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I'll stop here, and probably I'll also drop down this details in the Dropbox. Have a look. Okay. Surface water, and this is the only difference here. It is there is no flocculator. If it is no flocculator, the solids are very less, okay, then that you can call it as inline filtration. That's direct. After rapid mixing, it will go directly to a filter directly, okay, filtration unit, direct filtration. Okay, and instead of sedimentation, you can use flotation. Very simple. Please make a note on flotation. Flotation is a reverse of gravity. That's all. You can allow the particles to float at the top. Okay, that you would have seen a simple concept called any beverage bottle, say example Coca-Cola bottle, okay, and if you open up with the lid, what will happen? If you open a Coca-Cola bottle, if you open up a lid, what will happen? It will generate lot of air bubbles inside. You would have seen that, right? What does it mean? The pressure or the atmospheric pressure inside the bottle is lower than that of the outside pressure. And obviously, it will generate a lot of bubbles, okay? Or you can remember simply, this is, if you make a system is completely on vacuum and exposed to sudden atmospheric conditions, it will generate a lot of air bubbles. This air bubble will generate from bottom of the tank to top of the tank. And during this movement of or rise of air bubbles, it will take away a lot of sediments or a lot of these destabilized colloids to the top. That's what is being mentioned as reverse of gravity. Flotation is one technique of clarification or sedimentation, but the thing is reverse of gravity. Okay, that also we'll discuss. Dissolved flotation, and the groundwater is something is different. Okay, treatment system is something different. Then anyway, that we'll continue in the next class. Is it okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So please have a look. Of anyway, Saturday and Sunday is holiday for you, but probably you can also look into the numerical solutions what we discussed in the last week, and understand the basic dimensions of how the treatment chain or treatment layouts will look like for surface and groundwater treatment. Is it fine?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much.